We want to thank Susan and Stanford Carnahan. This webinar was made possible through their generous donation in memory of Marjorie Bush, whose Audubon bird prints started Susan on the road to becoming a craniac. And today, Susan is a member of the board of directors of the Crane Foundation. To learn more about sponsoring one of our webinars, please contact Kate Fitzwilliams. And there's the number and there's the email right there. Well, we're taking a very special trip tonight to the Kingdom of Bhutan. This is a small country about 250 miles east-west, and from the lowlands to the peaks of the Himalayas on the east-southeast side of the highest mountains in the world. It's going to be an exciting adventure tonight. Next slide. We have three speakers. I'm going to do the introduction. Then Jigme Tshering, who works for the Royal Society for the Protection of Nature, which is the foremost conservation organization private in Bhutan. And our colleague, David Hecht, who's done his graduate work from the University of Georgia, only he did his field work in Bhutan with Jigme. So we're all gonna speak to you tonight about Bhutan. And of course, the star of the show is the black-necked crane, Grus nigricollis. They have a cold black neck and a little white spot behind their bright yellow eye beneath the red crown, which can be expanded and contracted voluntarily. They're a bit off-white, and they're a little bigger than a sandhill crane, but not quite as big as a whooping crane. The juveniles are told by their dark plumage when they arrive in Bhutan in the winter. The bird in the middle, it looks much darker, but its neck is a little bit lighter. So by counting the number of juveniles, we can determine the productivity of the population, which should be between 10 and 15%. This is the distribution of the last crane to be described by science. And it was done by Dr. Przewalski way up in the north in 1887. So we have three major migration routes and we have a very scattered population across what we call the top of the world, the Tibetan Plateau. And you see the left arrow is heading right down into Bhutan. And that's where we're going this evening. First of all, a little bit about where the cranes breed. Lhasa is the capital of the province of Tibet in Western China. And this is the palace of the Dalai Lama, which is now a museum. One of the most beautiful buildings in the world. Outside, on the countryside, you have adobe homes surrounded by huge barley fields. This is at about 12,000 feet above sea level. And this is where most of the cranes come to spend the winter. The black-necked crane is a sacred bird. It's revered by the people on the Tibetan Plateau. And the cranes are often very trusting of humans. You can see them in the farm fields, sometimes very near the houses, sometimes farmers walking among the cranes. And then at night, they gather at areas of open water along the river or reservoirs, and they crowd in together. It's very cold at night, and that's where they sleep. In the spring, they start their dance, their courtship dance, at the beginning of the breeding season. And they migrate to high altitudes up to 16,000 feet above sea level, where they breed on alpine meadows. Before they leave, the Tibetan people do the first plowing of their land. They have a little ceremony. They dress up the yaks. They even give them a little rice wine. Next slide. They have a little temple there, portable temple. And the grandmother is throwing the wheat into the first furrow. The cranes are flying around, gaining altitude to go up to their breeding areas. And the Tibetans believe that the cranes are blessing their fields, and they don't want to plant their wheat until their fields are blessed. That's a painting in the background at the International Crane Foundation. And this is one of our pairs of captive black-necked cranes. But it shows the type of habitat in which they breed. Out in that pond, there's a little nest, and the local people with their yaks and their sheep and their goats are all around, and it's real harmony with nature. This is a real picture of a pair of black-necked cranes at their nest up in Tibet with some mallards out on the water. Then when it gets cold, they start their migration down to lower altitudes near Lhasa at 12,000 feet. But some of them, about 600 strong, soar way up in the air and fly over the Himalaya mountains to the valleys of Bhutan. So there's the location of Bhutan, the little star in the middle of the black thing. That's Bhutan. And to the west is Nepal. So Bhutan is sort of sandwiched between China and India. And like Tibet, Bhutan has the most beautiful architecture of their temples and monasteries. And it's a Buddhist culture in which they protect all forms of life. That's why it's such a fascinating place to visit. This is the Valley of the Cranes. There's the roost where they're sleeping overnight, very near to the people, just like up in Tibet. And the crane is a very important part in the culture of the Bhutanese too. You often see their paintings along with the sages. And this is Jigme. He is going to be our speaker tonight, telling us all about Bhutan. He's in his office at the Royal Society for the Protection of Nature. And this is David with Jigme. They were together as interns at the Crane Foundation a few years ago and became friends. And David decided to do his doctoral research in Bhutan. Here's Jigme with black-necked cranes in Baraboo, Wisconsin. He was a little younger, but he still looks pretty good. Next slide. And here he is in China last summer with a Tibetan monk. And one of the things the Crane Foundation does is bring people from different countries together. So we have sponsored twice groups of Bhutanese to come to the Tibetan plateau to meet their colleagues and their cranes up there. And here are David and Jigme in Bhutan wearing their goes, the national dress of Bhutan. And I'm going to turn the program over now to you, Jigme, and welcome to our webinar. He's in Bhutan, I'm in Baraboo, Wisconsin. What a wonderful world.
Hi. Hello, I'm Jigme from Bhutan, and thank you very much, George, for the wonderful introduction. I believe we have people from many parts of the world joining us today. So good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. It's indeed a very beautiful morning here in Bhutan. And we are just out of the second nationwide lockdown due to COVID-19 community outbreak. But nonetheless, I hope the situation in your respective places has eased and you are keeping safe. Right, so as George mentioned in his introduction, I will be talking about black-necked crane conservation in Bhutan. But I would like to thank ICF for putting together such important events where we can share our stories and learn from each other. But let me also start by expressing my sincere gratitude to all the supporters, donors, and conservation partners around the world in our efforts towards the black nectarine conservation in Bhutan. And ICF has been and continues to be our main partner for more than 2 decades now. So a big shout out to all the supporters and donors around the world. Next slide, please. I would like to briefly talk about RSPN, or the Royal Society for Protection of Nature, where I work, and its conservation program. Well, environmental conservation is given utmost priority by the king and the government. So therefore, it was under the royal command of His Majesty the Fourth King that RSPN was established as the first NGO for environmental conservation in 1987. It continues to have royal patronage, and currently Her Majesty, the Queen of Bhutan, is the royal patron. Well, RSPN began its conservation journey with a simple task of just keeping record and monitoring the black nectarines wintering in Bhutan. But over time, RSPN has widened its focus areas, becoming one of the major partners to the royal government of Bhutan in the conservation of the kingdom's natural heritage. The globe that you see here is RSPN's conservation mandala. The vision of the organization is to create an environmentally sustainable society as shown in the center. So to achieve this, we use 4 broad approaches shown in the outer circle. These 4 approaches represents the strength of the organization, which are used for implementing diverse programs under the 10 thematic areas shown in the second circle. But in the interest of time, I will not be talking about each one of them, but directly dive into today's topic, the black nectarine conservation program of RSPN. Next slide, please. So black nectarines are locally known as trung trung kam, literally meaning the white crane. So as George mentioned, out of the estimated global population of about 13,000, around 600 of them migrate to Bhutan every winter, making Bhutan the largest wintering site outside of China. So they spend around 5 months in Bhutan from end of October until mid of March. The picture that you see here is the Phobjikha Valley, located in central Bhutan and known for hosting the highest number of cranes in the winter, out of several other sites spread across the country. The valley has the largest pristine high altitude wetland in the country. The picture here represents the harmonious coexistence between the cranes and the community. As you can see, the settlements are located at the periphery of the wetland, leaving the entire wetland for the cranes to roost and forage for food. This vast undisturbed habitat has also benefited the local livestock, which goes on to benefit the cranes because of the grazing by the livestock. They maintain the vegetation at the suitable height for the cranes. So next slide, please. So again, as George mentioned, during the day, the cranes fly into nearby farmlands where they can find plenty of dropped grains, insects, and tubers. You can actually see the cranes up close during these times from the comfort of warm, you know, homestays, and can feel and sense the magnificence of these beautiful birds. And this particular picture was taken with a simple digital camera. So you can imagine like how close you can get to see these wildlife up close. Next slide, please. As in other countries, range countries, black nectarines are also revered as holy birds and very much embedded in the Bhutanese culture. David will be talking more on this later in his talk. But there are, yes, lots of folk songs, stories, and paintings of, you know, cranes in temples and homes are a common sight in Bhutan. This particular picture on the right is my favorite. It's from Phobjika. These beautiful ladies are performing a traditional crane dance at a local temple's annual festival. So next slide, please. The other festival which has become so much popular is the annual Black Neck Crane Festival organized at the courtyard of the Gangti Monastery in Phobjika every year on the 11th of November, which coincides with the birth anniversary of His Majesty the Fourth King. Well, RSPN and ICF started this festival in 1998 to raise awareness on the importance of Black Neck Crane conservation. But now it has actually become a tradition to host this festival annually, where several hundred international tourists also join the locals. Unfortunately, the last festival had to be organized behind closed doors. But fortunately, again, we could host audience virtually thanks to the technology. So anyway, during the day-long festival, local students, men, women, and monks perform cultural dances. And among these dances, the most popular one is the Black Neck Crane dance performed by the students, local students in their crane costume, as you can see in this picture. So so the next slide, please. Now, going to the population trend of Black Neck Cranes wintering in Bhutan, the overall trend, as you can see in this graph, we are observing an increasing trend. We have record from winter of 1986-87, the population has actually doubled from about 350 to now more than 600. But if you look at the local level, you can actually see varying trend, you know, with some sites seeing a decreasing number of cranes recorded. For instance, the green line, which shows the record of cranes wintering in Bumdeling, located in the eastern Bhutan. So as you can see, until mid-1990s, Bumdeling used to see more cranes than in Phobjika. But since then, the valley has been receiving a decreasing number of cranes from more than 200 to now less than 100 Black Neck Cranes wintering in that valley. So next slide, please. Well, out of many reasons, the declining trend has been attributed to the shrinking foraging grounds for the Black Neck Cranes. The foraging habitats are actually the post-harvest farmlands, and in Bhutan, these farmlands are being rapidly abandoned by farmers due to many factors. For instance, the shortage of laborers in the villages as young people move to urban areas, crop depredation by wildlife, and the annual flash floods during the monsoon seasons wash away the cultivated lands, and these contributes to the discouragement of the farmers to farm their farmlands, which contributes again towards the shrinking of the habitats for the cranes. So therefore, efforts to conserve these arable lands and to promote healthy agricultural practices are critical both for the humans, you know, welfare of the humans and the cranes. Next slide, please. Habitat fragmentation through encroachment, change in land use pattern, unregulated land use, and infrastructural development continues to pose threat to the maintenance of these pristine habitat for the cranes in Bhutan. So the next slide, please. Yes, there's natural predation by various wildlife, wild predators like this common leopard in all the habitats. These predators threatens the survival of the cranes, and recently the stray dogs have become a nuisance, you know, causing a major threat to the cranes, although we haven't had any reports of dogs preying on them. However, the increasing number of dog population in the wintering sites has definitely raised alarms. Next slide, please. So at the national level, the cranes are legally protected and listed under Schedule 1 within the Forest Nature Conservation Rules 2017, which means that it is illegal to possess or kill or harm the birds in any form. The three major wintering sites, Phobjikha and Khotokha in the central west and Bomdiling in the east, are declared as Ramsar site, meaning the wetlands of international importance. A long-term action plan for the conservation of black-necked crane in Bhutan is formulated, which is in fact a first of its kind, at least for the black-necked cranes in Bhutan. The national action plan would enhance coordination among the stakeholders and streamline conservation actions without duplication among the actors. Next slide, please. So when it comes to RSPN's role in the conservation of black-necked cranes, we focus on these five areas through community engagement, education and advocacy, through local and global partnership, research and habitat management. I will go through one by one activities that we implement within these five broad programs. Next slide, please. One of the key role RSPN played, has been in raising awareness and education among the stakeholders and the general public. Through this, the establishment of a black-necked crane visitor center in Phobjikha in 1999, the importance of black-necked crane was ingrained among the community. The center hosts and orients tens of thousands of visitors annually. And again, unfortunately, for the last 1 year, we didn't see any international visitors for like obvious reasons. But anyway, the center was further enriched with an addition of a live exhibition of black-necked crane, but of course, like unfortunate for the crane, but fortunate for the visitors, those who visit during the off black-necked crane season. The crane was found heavily injured with his left wing fractured, and later found out that the crane won't be able to fly again. So through the generous support from hundreds of individuals, both from local and international communities, this beautiful enclosure was built near the black-necked crane visitor center. You can see a mural of its summer habitat, which is in Tibet, so as to give the crane feeling of its it's both its home, homes, summer and the wintering homes. The crane was named Karma, and we recently came to know that Karma is a male and he's now 5 years old. Anyway, Karma amuses and inspires thousands of visitors who can witness this bird up close and learn about its many behaviors. In fact, the crane has become a celebrity in Bhutan. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. This winter, another crane was found injured and surrounded by stray dogs in Trongsa, which is the adjacent district. The crane was brought to Phobjikha, and we sent samples to Japan for gender identification, and Karma's prayer for a partner has been answered. The crane is a female. If the crane's born and mate, we will be seeing some cranes bred in Bhutan from now on. So next slide, please. Okay, on the research part, other than the usual habitat study that is being carried out, the tagging of black-necked cranes in Bhutan started in 1995 in partnership with ICF. In fact, George was there, and he actually caught two black-necked cranes in Bhutan and tagged them with PTT transmitters. Since then, over the years, we have more than 33 black Negroids with GBS transmitters on them, basically trying to understand their migratory patterns, their behavior, and their summer and wintering sites in Bhutan and in China. So next slide, please. Through such studies, we can approximately identify sites of the black Negroids. I know this slide, in this slide, you have a lot of many things to look at, but essentially this map shows the foraging and roosting site coverage, as well as the fly path within the country. But these are the three important sites where black Negroids are sighted every winter in Bhutan. So next slide, please. Next slide, please. Through our tagging program, we could also identify important summer and breeding sites of black Negroids. Those are wintering in Bhutan, in China. We are actually learning a lot of new things from every new tagged grains. For instance, here, the grain number 7116 traversed three countries, Bhutan, India, and China, which is quite a new, at least for me, new information that we could derive from this particular study on the migratory study of the black Negroids. Next slide, please. On the habitat management, through the support from the Austrian government and the Royal government, about 30 kilometers of electric cables were laid underground in Phobjikha, so as to avoid deadly collisions of the cranes with the overhead power lines. It also promotes maintaining the aesthetic beauty of the valley. And recently in Bhumtang, David was also there who joined us in this activity of installing fly diverters along the selected overhead cables in Bhumtang, especially the ones nearby the roosting sites of the black Negroids. Next slide, please. Continuing with the habitat management, we carry out annual maintenance of roosting areas whereby tall vegetations are removed and create clear shallow ponds for the cranes to roost in safely. During such activities, we involve locals and then they do enjoy the work and often shares that this is one direct participatory, contribution from their side that they can offer for the crane conservation as a local sharing the land with the cranes. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. So as a part of enhancing the foraging habitats for the black Negroids and to combat shrinking foraging habitat for the cranes, we encourage cultivation of rice, which is the favorite food for the wintering cranes. RSPN provided funding for farmers to remain on the land by placing electric fencing around their fields to prevent crop damage by wildlife. We have also initiated restoration of degraded paddy fields by removing flood debris. So far, we have restored and provided with proper fencing for more than 100 acres of paddy field, which has benefited about 113 households, approximately 500 individual farmers. So as we strive to provide more excellent rice, paddy, winter feeding areas for the cranes, we hope the number of cranes wintering in that valley increases over time. So the next slide, please. So way forward, while the effort is there, challenge for RSPN is to keep up with the issues and threats that come with changing time and situation. It entails that consistent effort and need to keep up reinventing our actions and to address the increasing challenges. Moreover, our current effort is thinly spread and needs enhancement and scaling up at landscape level so as to allow long-term visible impact. We have the action plans and strategies in place. However, what we lack is consistent resources, especially in terms of financial resources. Therefore, RSPN aspires to create an endowment fund to support annual operational activities associated with the conservation of the cranes. This fund would benefit both the sustainability and consistency of our programs. We will continue to focus in enhancing the foraging habitat, especially in Bumdeling, the eastern habitat. Through our studies and findings, we hope to recommend establishment of sister conservation in their breeding and summer habitats in Tibet in China. We continue to improve our networking and information sharing among the range countries. And we also continue to seek continued support and participation from international partners like ICF and from individuals like David, with whom we have been working for last few years now. And finally, we would like to thank our donors and partners around the globe for being part of this great initiative and hope to receive continued support from you all. That's all for now from my side. I'll hand over to George.
No, we're going to hear from David next. Are you all set, David?
All set.
Here we go.
Thank you so much, Jigme and George. It was such an honor, of course, for me to work with RSPN and to have your continued guidance during our research period. And of course, all of the work that we did previous to that work together at RSPN. And of course, it is such a pleasure to be here with all of you today who are tuning in. Thank you so much for joining for another evening from the field webinar. And of course, for your kind attention as we move into the final portion of our webinar this evening. So in this part, I will be drawing from a long-term research project that has been the subject of my PhD dissertation. And it takes place in the habitats and surrounding communities of the black-necked cranes and addresses some of the more human and cultural dimensions of conservation and hopefully conservation decision-making in the Kingdom of Bhutan. I hope to be able to point to some of the reasons why Bhutan is such a gem and exemplar to the rest of the world as a refuge of both ecological and cultural diversity and integrity, and hopefully demonstrate how our interdisciplinary research reflects these truths in active ways. So as mentioned, my name is David Hecht, and I'm a PhD candidate in integrative conservation and anthropology at the University of Georgia. So I'm a student of culture, community, and conservation. And as an environmental anthropologist, my research focuses on the cultural dimensions of community-based conservation and asks what lessons and perspectives can be gained from local and traditional knowledge holders in the places where conservation work happens. So as Jigme mentioned, I recently returned to the US from nearly 2 years spent in Bhutan in 2019 and 2020, finalizing my dissertation research with years prior spent in Bhutan before I started graduate school, as George indicated. In my PhD research, I use maps and mapping techniques like you see in this photo here, and community ethnography, which is a common term in anthropology, to better understand the role of community values and beliefs, as well as the ways in which lived religion conditions the cultural landscapes within and around areas of conservation concern for black-necked cranes. So my work also interfaces with efforts to protect the critically endangered white-bellied heron, but that is sadly beyond the scope of today's talk. But from the very beginning, I started working with RSPN and colleagues there to make sure my research, our research, aligned with existing long-term programs at the institution to complement some of the really important ongoing efforts that RSPN has been engaged with for many decades. So the field sites of my research are the same sites and communities where RSPN invests their efforts. And I just wanted to say that while, of course, my mentors are many, both Jigme and George have been immensely influential mentors. And I just wanted to make sure I front-loaded my part of today's webinar with some heartfelt gratitude for you both. I owe much to your guidance, support, and friendships over the years. All right, let's start here with this photo. As Jigme mentioned, cranes are widely considered to be heavenly birds in Bhutan, winged emissaries that are so richly intertwined in the fabric of places and local communities to exist in their songs and stories, commonly gracing the walls of homes and buildings of cultural significance. And indeed, so important are they as to merit a place in Gangte Gimpa, the central monastery in the Valley of Pobjuka. Carved into the ornate pillars of the monastery here under thunder dragons and powerful protective deities, as you see in this photo. So as a cultural anthropologist working in conservation, I want to better understand the human dimensions of these place-based stories and relationships and see how they interface with efforts to protect species and their habitats. As George mentioned in the beginning with his slide on Ho-Chunk land acknowledgement and Baraboo, I myself am dedicated to amplifying local voices and perspectives in this pursuit. And my doctoral research, while not quite yet in all the places where cranes dance, you know, more certainly I strive to meet this goal in Bhutan and in my research. Now, in order to effectively address the many environmental challenges facing our planet, I believe in the power of strengthening and integrating diverse voices and knowledges to find common ground for environmental action in research, policy, and management. And like ICF and RSPN, I feel strongly that partnerships with local people and communities is invaluable to achieving this success. From the research side of things, that sentiment goes even deeper. So in my scholarship, I work to better understand local values, beliefs, perceptions, and people's relationship with their local environments. Because for me, it is not just about documenting the community knowledge and putting it in, say, a cultural archive or an academic book or a dissertation, but using it and allowing it to influence our own values and perspectives to ultimately make better decisions for biodiversity conservation. Doing that demonstrates to local people, our partners, that not only are they stakeholders in the collective efforts to protect our planet's natural heritage, but they are in fact collaborators, thought partners in these efforts. And that conservation too can work in a way that protects their cultural and national heritage by amplifying their voices. So although my research covers a lot of ground, that is really my starting point with all of this. I start with that humility in knowing the Bhutanese cultural world is incredibly rich and diverse for such a small kingdom, expressed across many languages, ethnic groups, and places. And of course, we couldn't possibly do justice to the complexities therein in this webinar. But suffice to say, broadly in Bhutan, though there are many religious expressions, of course, pre-Buddhist belief systems, so indigenous animism or bonche, were historically fortified by Tibetan Buddhist religious systems. And in this religious context, there are local deities and non-human spirits who are known to occupy territory on the landscape, so in forests, cliffs, rocks, lakes, springs, and ancient old growth trees, such as this giant cypress here in this photo, that is found in Bhutan, Bhutan near Lame Gimpa. This tree is the abode of a local deity, with offerings made at the annual ritual you see here to appease this local deity and ensure health and prosperity in the community. These rituals for the deity ensure a good harvest in the rice paddy, healthy livestock, and good weather. Deities and spirits are everywhere in Bhutan, and many local deities play important roles in the lives of people and often powerfully mediate relationships between communities and their environments. These gods of the territory, places, and settlements go by many different names, but generally are referred to as Yulajida or Nedajida, and their territories and areas are described as the deity's palace or citadel of the deity or Pojong. Generally in these places, one is not allowed to cut trees, extract resources, pollute the area, either physically or spiritually, and in some cases even enter these territories in forests, lakes, or mountaintops. Thus, these natural areas are protected from exploitation and safeguarded by local communities. Documenting this knowledge, these local perspectives, works to preserve Bhutan's cultural heritage and environmental heritage, and can powerfully complement long-term ecological or wildlife research by integrating local, traditional, and indigenous knowledge to make conservation and policy decisions work better for the people who live there. So how do we do that? Well, as a conservation social scientist, I have certain tools and methods that have proved valuable for illuminating often untapped knowledge in conservation conversations, namely interviews, community discussions, as you see here, surveys, and then something called participatory mapping, all of which take many forms. And I will explain briefly about some of the tenets of participatory mapping, as that was a core of our research. So I'll start with something called sketch mapping. It's about as you would expect. In order to better understand these deeply cultural landscapes where you find cranes, it can be as simple as asking local experts to draw their community on a blank sheet of paper and the places in their community that are important to them. So this man here you see in the photo joined a group of other local government officials and tsokpas to draw his jurisdiction in Pobjika. You know, he drew important buildings like hospitals, temples, and schools. He drew important ecological features like the river and the wetland and the Ramsar site. And if you zoomed in to this particular picture at the top, you would see the names of local deities written in Dzongka script on the mountainsides. So the Yulajida, the Nedajida of Pobjika, whose hillside territories surround Pobjika's wetland. These powerful invisible beings and other non-human spirits share the same physical space as humans and wildlife like birds or cranes. And just like humans' relationships with different wildlife, community relationships with local deities need to be cultivated and tended and cared for through annual rituals and ceremonies primarily, as well as the enforcement of certain social and communal rules, such as not cutting down trees within the deity's territory or entering during the wrong time of year. So this method, this sketch mapping method, is great. Though it can be done in a group, it is best done with individuals to see what is important to them and how their community looks to them in their mind's eye. So we employed other participatory mapping methodologies that benefited group conversations, using a printed map like this to have individuals and participants label important places on the landscape. Anything from, you know, previous sightings of black-necked cranes, development projects that are underway that people feel uncertain about, or the names and sites and territories of local deities. This was a highly effective method for understanding the territorial nature of deities and their proximity to conservation protected areas and sites of conservation significance, because it allowed community members to discuss with one another their shared experiences and knowledge. This process also allowed us to have cross-generational conversations, which is important in this context, as evidence suggests much of this knowledge is not being passed down to the next generation. The traditional knowledge holders tend to be elder members of the community. And so it's not an exaggeration to suggest this knowledge could disappear within a generation or so. When these traditions change, we have to ask ourselves, what will take their place and how will they adapt? As of course, all knowledge adapts, all cultures adapt. How will communities and their environments remain resilient with all of these new changes? And of course, the last method I wanted to talk about, any social scientist's bread and butter, or in Bhutan's case, rice and chilies, in-depth interviews and surveys allowed us to speak one-on-one with our conservation partners and participants in our field sites across the years. So in one avenue of our research, we wanted to see how successfully we could bring this mapped community data into a format that does not reduce the complexity of this knowledge, but instead seeks to amplify, honor, and preserve this rich heritage. So I had this idea to not simply integrate our participatory mapping data into a database in a computer for research purposes or for manipulation with a GIS, for instance, but to create a cultural landscape mapping series that is in fact painted. So done in the traditional Tibetan Bhutanese style and illuminate the elders' perspectives, Bhutanese traditional knowledge holders, members of the community that are, you know, so important for a resilient future, but they're so frequently overlooked. So our goal with this project was to map all of the places where cranes dance in Bhutan in this style. How do we do that? It sounds complicated, right? Believe me, it is incredibly involved and complicated. And to be done properly and fully, I'm feeling more and more like it would require a lifetime or perhaps multiple lifetimes. And I tend to be a little overly ambitious by nature, but I have incredible people like Jigme and Indra and George and others at RSPN and beyond who have helped immensely along the way. So I acknowledge that we have just a few minutes left, but I want to explain how we might go about creating such an interesting novel map of this type by way of a quick example. So here is a familiar view to some of us. This is Phobjikha. We see here in this photo, potato and turnip fields. We might see a traditional farmhouse, a wetland where cranes roost and feed, and hilltop forests rimming the valley. So this is the visible landscape. And from our eyes as a tourist or a visitor, these are some of the important features on the landscape. You know, if I were an ecologist or collaborating with an ecologist, they could tell me a lot about the soil nutrient load in the turnip fields, the risks of taking too many fertilizer inputs, or Jigme could maybe point to the impact of dwarf bamboo succession on crane roosting ponds in the wetland complex. Or maybe a forester would look at this picture and explain to me that the tree species composition of the forest in the background is important for the future of a functioning watershed, you know, replenishing the wetland ecosystem. And of course, we know these are all important perspectives that help us to better understand this place and its needs. It also informs how we protect it for years to come and what national policies are made to ensure that happens. So here's another photo, a painting, in fact, of the same place in Phobjikha. And depending on who is looking at this painting, you likely see cranes, people in their photo, in their potato fields, but through the eyes of a local elder, a community expert who has lived here his or her entire life, looking across the Ramsar site to the forested hillside, looming like a citadel or a palace over the wetland, would be a place known well as the residence of a local deity, a god of this territory, Ulajida. And like many local deities, we know this particular deity is referred to with the kinship term Age, which means grandfather, while other deities in the valley are referred to as Ap, for father, or Ange, for grandmother. And of course, there are dozens here in this small part of the valley. as well. And some that certainly I don't know about, but exist in the minds and lives of community elders. So this is the important point. Depending on who is looking, this landscape holds different features of significant importance. As conservationists, we can do more to ensure these local voices and Indigenous perspectives have a seat at the decision-making table. So we tried that. We did that, at least in part, at least as much as time and resources allowed. So we used our participatory mapping methods to understand and map these cultural landscapes with our community conservation partners. Here is a bird's eye view of that map of the same landscape in the photos we just saw. Every yellow tag you see in this map is a local deity or a site of religious significance. The main deities are found here surrounding the protected Ramsar site indicated in yellow. In some ways, this ensures that the forests and watershed of Pobjika are protected by the community and are intact, unpolluted, and generally undisturbed. And it has been this way for generations, for centuries. Let's look at another example quickly in Bomdeling in the northeast part of the country, host to the second largest population of wintering cranes and the sites of a lot of RSPN and ICF-led efforts to restore these habitats. So in the relatively small community of Bomdeling, we find that we could map hundreds of non-human spirits and local deities, same as almost anywhere. But many of the main powerful deities of Bomdeling were put on the map here in the blue circles by the hands of our research participants. And there again is the foraging and roosting sites in the center of the map for blackneck cranes. The deities in their territories are gestured here. And I just wanted to give you another quick version, a 3D version of that same map. So if these important roosting and foraging sites for cranes and other wildlife are surrounded and intersected by the territories and habitats of local deities, respected by local people and protected through certain social regulations against over-harvesting, against the over-extraction of resources, the felling of trees, pollution of any kind, then, and we know that these territories are everywhere, we can begin to appreciate one of the reasons why Bhutan is such an ecological and cultural gem to the rest of the world, why they have maintained their old growth forests, alpine lakes, and healthy watersheds. These indigenous traditions are alive and function in service of these intact ecosystems. And as conservation researchers, if we make sure we put these perspectives on the map, then we are not only seeing local communities as stakeholders, but as partners and collaborators in our shared efforts to protect culturally revered spaces and culturally revered species. How we map our landscape conditions how we see them and thus how we protect them. So through RSPN and our partners with the Department of Culture and the Ministry of Home and Cultural Affairs, we forged a fruitful collaboration with a traditional contemporary artist to paint a series of these maps in all of the places where cranes dance in Bhutan. So this is a map, one of five, that I'm hopeful will succeed in the future and represent four of the other places in Bumthang, Pobjika, Lunsi, and Tashiyangsi. And we are eager to see how this project evolves. Of course, there's so much detail in this map that will simply have to be the topic of another webinar, another day, and another talk. But thank you all so much for your kind attention. Hopefully we have time for at least a few questions. Thank you all so much.
Oh, thank you so much, David. That was wonderful. And now we have Spike Millington, who's been harvesting questions. Spike, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Wow, what a fantastic presentation. Thanks a lot, George. Thanks, Jigme. Thanks, David. It's really fantastic, the work that RSPN is doing. And it's really fascinating, the research that that David is doing. I know we could spend a whole other webinar just talking about the same things. But we don't have time, I'm afraid. We had many questions. So one thing I can say is that we won't get through all the questions. but they will all be answered. So we'll answer the questions that are here. We have those documented. And when you get a copy of the recording, there'll be another opportunity to ask questions too. And those will be answered too. I know that the panelists are very keen to answer all of these questions. And they're very, 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 very interesting questions. But we have time, I think, perhaps for a couple. The first one, actually, there are several questions about international cooperation, how Bhutan works with other countries of the region. You mentioned India and China. Is there some kind of cooperative activity to take care of the black-necked cranes throughout the range? Do you have that international cooperation? Maybe Jigme, you could answer that.
Thank you for the question. I think it's a very important question. Formally, we do not have this transboundary conservation cooperations among the range countries, India, China, and Bhutan, but we do share information among these countries, and then we work through international organizations like ICF and BirdLife International as well. But for now, we do not really have that formal cooperation, you know, in terms of black-necked crane conservation. But as we have these kind of, you know, informal sort of sharing of knowledge and, you know, information, we come to know about the status of those areas where black-necked cranes reside. So as and then we suggest or recommend for, you know, protecting those areas. So that's my take on it.
Yeah, I can just add that we hope that a sister relationship will be established between the breeding areas in China and the wintering areas in Bhutan. And we hope these talks can occur at high levels in the countries, but it starts at the bottom, and we're at the bottom.
What I do know also is that the personal relations between the crane researchers, the crane conservationists in those three countries is very, very strong. You know, everyone knows each other and they work very well together. So the potential for cooperation is really there. So I'm very optimistic about that. Another question is about the threats really to black-necked cranes. And there's one question about whether farming is a real threat. Another question was about dams. I think that was more for China, how that would affect the wetlands. And then, you know, what about the dogs? How do you deal with those situations and the people abandoning the land? So how do you deal with all of these threats? If they are threats.
Why don't you just do one of them because of our time? Talk about what you're doing about the dogs, Jigme.
We do have, along with the Department of Livestock and Department of Forest, we collaborate in, it's of course like a temporary measure, but somehow in the long run, it might help. But we do this annual castrations of the selected dog population in those, especially in those wintering habitats. It's a big challenge when it comes to, you know, the other option is, you know, removing those dogs, but we cannot also hurt the sentiments. And then, so the only option that we have here is working with the communities there, not to, you know, feed, you know, stray dogs and, you know, increase the population of dogs in those areas. But other than that, for now, we don't have any other options but to carry out these annual castration programs that we do.
Okay, thanks, Jigme. And one final question, very easy one for David, seeing he hasn't had any yet. One question is, do you speak Bhutanese? Because we assume that people there are not really speaking very much English.
Yeah, gratefully, you know, I would say English is pretty common as a second language. I am currently taking lessons in Dzongkha. I have a teacher that I jump on online with every week. I would call myself an intermediate Dzongkha speaker, but I'm hoping that it will be something that I can cultivate over a lifetime and a career. I would love to be fluent in Dzongkha, gratefully. English is quite widely spoken, but I would say that, you know, folks like Jigme were indispensable to my research. I couldn't have done anything without him. So Jigme deserves all the credit there as translator and host.
Thanks, David. Well, good luck with your lessons. We'll ask you again in 10 years' time. Okay, that's it for the questions. I'm handing back to George now. But just to say again that your questions will be answered. There are so many and they are so interesting. George, over to you.
Okay, let's have the next slide. I want to thank Susan and Sanford Carnahan again for this program. Thank you very, very much. Next slide. And join us for our next field webinar. It's called Switching the Curve, What It Takes to Reverse the Decline of Three Crane Species. From South Africa's regional manager, Tanya Smith, who's an absolutely terrific, charismatic person. And that's going to be sponsored by Anne and Hall Healy. Thank you, Anne and Hall. And great news, the cranes are increasing in South Africa because of the wonderful efforts of the Endangered Wildlife Trust and partnership with ICF. Next slide. This presentation and our work is made possible by the support of people like you. Thank you very much, members of the Crane Foundation. We are a nonprofit organization working in about 50 countries. We have 80 people on our staff, a huge budget we have to fill every year, and we are very, very grateful for that help. So I hope that those who aren't a member will sign up. And that's our website, www.savingcranes.org. We thank you, thank you, thank you. And especially tonight, we thank major supporters of our work in Bhutan, Douglas Krupp, and Jennifer Spears and others. Thank you so much for your help, major help in Bhutan. Thank you, Jigme and David.